Welcome back. In this session, we are going to see the topic called polarization. This is very important for GATE. It is going to give us around 1 to 2 marks for sure, and very easy to score also. So we'll see much details about polarization now. Right on. Polarization. First point. It is a term applicable only for electric field. It is a term applicable only for electric field. That means we cannot apply polarization concept for magnetic field. The reason is we cannot separate two magnetic charge particles wherein we can separate two electrical charge particles. If we can separate two charge particles, then we can say the charges are getting polarized. Therefore this is a topic applicable only for electric field. Second point, as I told you, this is applicable only for electric field. Electric field is a vector quantity. In one of our previous lectures, we decided to denote the vector quantities with a arrow, right? We can show a vector with the help of an arrow. Any vector can be visualized with the help of an arrow. Because it is a time varying quantity, let us say at t is equal to 0 seconds, the tip of the arrow at this location. And at t is equal to t1 seconds, let's say the tip of the arrow is at this point. Because this is a time varying quantity, right? At t is equal to t2 seconds, let's say the tip of the arrow is at this location. If you can join all those points, then you can get a root locus of that, right? So basing on this root locus, now I can able to trigger, or I can able to figure out the direction of electric field. Electric field is initially in certain direction. After that, at t2 seconds, it has come to certain point. So we can kind of figure out based on this root locus. Therefore, polarization gives the direction of electric field. Right on. Second point, polarization gives the direction of electric field. Polarization gives the direction of electric field. Next, types of polarization. So first one, linear polarization. Second one, circular polarization. Again, in circular there are two types. One is left circular polarization and the other one is right circular polarization. One is left circular polarization and other one is right circular polarization. Third one, elliptical polarization. Again, this one can be classified into two types: left elliptical polarization and right elliptical polarization. Left elliptical polarization and right elliptical polarization. Basically, there are three types of polarization: linear, circular, and elliptical. Third, linear polarization. We discuss in detail about what is linear polarization. Linear polarization. So before going to linear polarization, let us see some basics and come back to that. After learning some lessons from these basics, we'll apply these basics on the linear polarization, right? First, let us do the background work now. I'm going to give you two signals. Let's say this is x1 of t. We know signal is a function of time. And let's say one more signal, x2 of t, something like this. So out of these two signals, which one is linear and which one is non-linear is our area of interest. Both are a straight lines, and the equation of this line is y is equal to mx plus c, because these are some y-intercept, and this is a straight line passing through origin, so the line is called as y is equal to mx. Mathematically, y power 1 and x power 1, that is y is equal to mx plus c and y is equal to mx, both are linear. But if you're concerned about the signal point of view or system point of view, any signal or system which follows y is equal to mx rule is only said to be linear. Any system or any signal which follows y is equal to mx rule, it is only said to be linear. We don't take y is equal to mx as mx plus c as linear signal or linear system. So basically, in signals and systems, if you want to check the linearity of a signal or system, you'll be applying the superposition theorem. So from now onwards, we can adopt this simple technique. If you can see the signal equation as y is equal to mx, then you can call that signal as a linear signal. Therefore, we kind of adopt the same principle for our linear polarization. But keep in mind that you can make a note of this point, maybe somewhere in the rough. So any signal or system which obeys y is equal to mx rule is said to be linear. Graphically, they should pass through a straight, there is a straight line passing through origin. You should not have any y-intercept, right? Now we'll take the advantage of this topic and apply onto the polarization. Now, instead of discussing about polarization and applying on an example, what we do some kind of reverse engineering. I will take an example and I will prove that example as an linearly polarized. Now we will identify the conditions that make that equation to become linear polarization. So those are the conditions that E bar has to satisfy to become linearly polarization. So we can make a note of those points at the end. So what we do, we take an example and prove that example as linearly polarized, and then we'll identify the conditions which make that electric field to become linear polarization. So those are the conditions that it has to meet to become linearly polarized. Now, as I told you, polarization is a topic applicable only for electric field, and any vector can be decomposed into two components. Now I will decompose this electric field into two components. Let's say some x component as ex naught sine omega t minus beta z. I'll tell you, so sine omega t minus beta z a x cap plus e y naught sine omega t minus beta z a y cap. Let's say, for example, I have decomposed this electric field into two components. One is x component and the second one is y component. What is omega t minus beta z? All these things we'll bother about later. But if something equation is given to you something like this, then this is called as x component and this is called as y component, right? Now, this is x component, let us take it as x, and this is y component, let us take it as y. Now, simply take the ratio of y by x. Y by x is equal to e y naught sine omega t minus beta z by e x naught sine omega t minus beta z. Since both of these terms are similar, I can cancel them. It is going to be E by naught is a constant, E x naught is also constant, so I can take that constant as sum m, therefore it is y is equal to m x. This is a time varying quantity which has been turned up into y is equal to, which has following y is equal to mx rule, therefore this is linearly polarized. Now what are the conditions that made that electric field to become linearly polarized? Because this sine terms has been cancelled out. Why they have cancelled out? Because the phase difference between x component and y component is zero. The phase difference is basically zero. If suppose, let us say for example, if there is a phase difference, then these two terms will not be cancelled out, they will be existing. If they exist, it will become like y is equal to mx into tan x or y is equal to mx into cot x. That is not linear, right? So to make this as linear, these two functions got cancelled out. That means the phase difference between the components must be zero. Then what about the strength of the components? Strength of the components are different basically, right? If they are different, I'll be getting m, but if they are same, I'll be getting as x. Or sorry, I'll be getting as 1. Therefore, the equation will become y is equal to x. Y is equal to x or y is equal to mx, both are linear. There is no impact of strength on the linearity. There is an impact of only the phase difference on the linearity. Write down conditions for linear polarization. What is the condition? Conditions for linear polarization. Write down what is the condition. Condition for linear polarization. Write down. The phase difference between the components, the phase difference between the components, components means magnitudes, right? These are the magnitudes. The phase difference between the components must be zero. Comma, the strength of the components may be same or different. They can be same or they can be different, that doesn't matter, but the phase difference between the components must be zero. This is must, but the strength of the components may be same or different, then we can say the polarization is linearly polarized. Suppose the question has been given something like this: see the phase difference between the components, it is zero, right? So it is linearly polarized. The strength of the components, they can be same or different, doesn't matter, still it is a linearly polarized. So these are the conditions for, this is the condition for linear polarization, right? You can take that as an example, which is obeying y is equal to mx. Y is equal to mx and y is equal to x, where m is equal to 1, both are linear, right? Next, so before going to circular polarization and electrical polarization, let us prepare or let us do some background work and prepare ourselves for circular and electrical polarization. So for a while, let us discuss a few points. Write down note points, very 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 important note points. So very important note points, just write down, I'll explain you later. First point, any time varying field can be represented mathematically can be represented mathematically with suppose, say for example, we have electric field and we have magnetic field. Both are time varying quantities, right? If somebody want to show the time varying phenomenon mathematically, what or how they will be representing that time varying phenomenon mathematically. So that's what we are discussing as a first point. Any time varying field can be represented mathematically with sine or cos or complex exponential. So usually we take the help of sine function or cos function or combination of these two, which is complex exponential function, to represent a time varying phenomenon, right? I will show you, I will explain you all these points with an example, but as of now, plus initially we'll write down all these note points, and then we'll discuss here. We'll take an example and apply all these points over there. Second point. Now, suppose somebody comes to you and asks you to write sine function. How will you write the sine function? Basically, how will you represent sine function? So we write something like this: sine function as some constant a sine some bracket term, right? Something we'll write in the bracket, like sine omega t or something. So this is what we usually write for sine function, cos function, exponential function. Now, especially my focus is on this bracket term. This is very important or very helpful to me if I focus on the bracket term. What is that? Right, the second point. The bracket term, right as it is, because there is no harm in writing in common man terms, which is very, because if you write in common man terms, it will be very easy for us to understand. The bracket term of sine or cos or complex exponential, the bracket term of sine, cos or complex exponential represents the direction of propagation of EM wave. Basically, the bracket term of sine, cos or exponential will tell us what is the direction of electromagnetic wave. We can figure out from the bracket term. The bracket term of sine, cos, exponential represents direction of propagation of electromagnetic wave. Third point. If the wave is propagating in, if the wave is propagating in positive direction physically, then if the wave is traveling in positive direction physically, then we represent it mathematically with negative direction. And vice versa. So what are the third point means is, suppose the wave is traveling in positive x direction physically, the wave is going in positive x direction, but mathematically we show it as minus x, and vice versa. Suppose physically the wave is traveling in negative x direction, we show that mathematically with plus x. So what are the physically it is oriented, the orientation we show in with the opposite sign mathematically. So first point is, to capture the time varying field mathematically, we take the help of sine, cos, complex exponential. The bracket term of those functions will tell us direction of propagation of EM wave. If EM wave is traveling in positive axis physically, we show it negative mathematically, and vice versa. So that is what the third point. Next. Fourth point. Fourth point. Wave, right on. Fourth point. Wave always travels in TEM mode. Wave always travels in TEM mode in unbounded mediums, in unbounded mediums, in bracket space and transmission lines, and transmission lines. So wave, the propagation of wave is basically in TEM mode. In which medium? It is in unbounded medium. The best example for unbounded medium is space, the free space, and the transmission line. In transmission lines also the wave propagates in TEM mode. Now I'll tell you what is TEM mode is. Transverse electromagnetic mode, and basically transverse means 90 degrees. What is the meaning of transverse? It is 90 degrees. To what? It should be 90. To what? It should be 90. Right? The point is, to the direction of propagation of electromagnetic wave, electric field should be in transverse 90, magnetic field should be in transverse 90. So this is the wave. Always keep remember that the thumb is used to denote electric field, and this so always remember that the thumb rule is, we always denote electric field with thumb and magnetic field with index finger, the wave with middle finger. So this always indicates the wave, and this always indicates the magnetic field, and this always indicates electric field. Now, to the direction of propagation of electromagnetic wave, electric field should be 90, magnetic field should be 90, and all these three in perpendicular to each other. Such a kind of mode is called as transverse electromagnetic mode. So now, how to model this mathematically? I want to say that electric field direction AE cap and magnetic field direction AH cap and electromagnetic wave direction AEM cap, and all these three directions are normal to each other. That means A bar plus B bar equals C bar, where C is normal to both A and B, and A and B are obviously normal here, right? So this is what the mathematical representation for TEM, direction of electric field cross direction of magnetic field, is equal to direction of electromagnetic wave. And remember that thumb always used to indicate electric field, and index finger always used to represent magnetic field, and middle finger is always used to represent electromagnetic wave. So, and all these three are perpendicular to each other. Such a kind of pattern we usually called as, or mode is called as, transverse electromagnetic mode.